I'd like to welcome all of you to the ICS faculty panel on improving your graduate school applications. Students often ask me, is graduate school worth it? How can I tell if it's for me? And here on the wall are the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics that clearly prove that graduate school is worth it. On the left is the unemployment rate, on the right, the median weekly earnings, and it goes from less than a high school diploma at the bottom, climbing up the food chain through bachelor's, master's, to a doctorate degree at the top. And clearly the statistics demonstrate that the higher up the food chain you climb, the lower your unemployment, and the more money you make. So yes, it is worth it. The question of, is it for you? Grad school is for you if you believe you are worth making an investment in yourself. You are the best possible investment, and an investment in your future is the best thing you can do. What's not shown on this chart is that the interestingness and responsibilities climb as you go up the food chain. At the bachelor's level, you might be a project team member. With the master's, you might be a project team leader or a division leader. With a doctorate degree, you might be a chief technical officer or a researcher in a think tank. We're going to begin with the presentation by Daniel Fabrega, special guest. He is the UCI Graduate Division Coordinator for Outreach, Recruitment, and Retention. Daniel, thank you very much.
Hello, everybody. In a few minutes, my name is Daniel. I work in the Graduate Division. Have any of you guys heard of the Graduate Resource Center? Anybody? One person? Okay, that's fine. Most undergraduates aren't aware. So some services our office provides for students like yourself. So in the Graduate Resource Center, which is on the third floor of Gateway Study Center, it's the entire third floor, we have writing consultants from a range of disciplines that can actually look over your application essays for you. So before you bring it to your faculty advisor to kind of tear it apart, it's always good to have somebody else tear it apart before you give it to your professor, so they can, instead of saying like, this is not good, like, this is pretty good, here's some more edits. So anything graduate application focused, they'll look over. I also do one-on-one graduate advising, and so if you have like just general specific questions, you can schedule an appointment with the Graduate Resource Center. The number is 949-824-3849. Or email grc@uci.edu, whichever is easier to remember. And then also we do a workshop series in the fall on know-how sessions. So it's kind of similar to the information you get here, but from a student's perspective on getting into graduate school. And then there's a flyer over there as well. And I have my card there as well. And I think that's everything. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Dan. I'd like to introduce our faculty panel. Starting from your point of view, from left to right. First, we have Sandy Irani, professor of computer science and former chair of the department, whose area is algorithms and complexity. Dan Gillen, a professor of statistics, who works in statistics and statistical theory. Amelia Reagan, professor of computer science, who works in algorithms and complexity and networks and distributed systems. Gary Olson, Brin Professor of Information and Computer Sciences in the Department of Informatics. He works in computer-supported cooperative work, human-computer interaction, and social informatics. L.A. Bazurgatzada, Professor of Computer Science, works in computer architecture and design. Ian Harris, Vice Chair of Undergraduate Studies, Computer Science, who works in Computer Architecture and Design and Embedded Systems. And Christina Lopez, who is Faculty Chair of the ICS Executive Committee from the Department of Informatics, works in Programming Languages and Systems, Software Engineering, and Ubiquitous Computing. I've distributed to each one of the professors a compilation of questions that students ask, and each one of them has a particular topic that they've been put in charge of. So I'm going to begin by asking each one of them to give a 60 to 90 second soundbite. The short answer to my question is, and the short answer is, then we'll let the panel elaborate on those answers for about 10 minutes. Then I'll open the floor to general questions from the audience. At 12:50, I will shoo the faculty panel out so that the graduate students can get started, and we'll make the faculty leave so that the students can speak honestly and openly. And then we'll have some current graduate students who told you what they did to become successful. And the panel will close at 1:30. So without further ado, Professor Irani, if you could start with your question and lead us through.
Okay, how are PhD and master's applications different? Well, I guess I'll say how the programs are different because that drives the applications. And the one word answer is research. A PhD program, the main focus is doing original research. Whereas master's, you may do a master's thesis, but the main focus is taking classes and expanding your knowledge through instructional in the classroom. You can get a great job with either one. A lot of wonderful jobs out there in industry with a master's degree. Typically, a PhD student is funded, either in a research assistantship or a teaching assistantship. Typically, master's students are not funded.
Forgive me. I've been informed that people in the back can barely hear, so we're going to try to use the mic after
okay.
all.
Does that help? Typically a master's student doesn't receive funding to go to school, and PhD students do. And faculty tend to be more invested in their PhD students because that drives their research program. But you really should only get the PhD if you think that research is for you. This is actually not a great reason to go on and get a PhD because you can earn a little bit more money. It's really a very different activity. And if it's a good match for you, do it. But if it's not, then there are a lot of wonderful opportunities with a master's degree.
Okay. So how can I decide which schools and programs to apply for? The short answer here is you need to do your homework and you need to learn about their individual programs. You need to learn about the individual strengths of a particular program and the relative strengths of a particular program relative to other programs in the country or in the world, for example. I think a lot of people do make the mistake of thinking that programs are equally ranked with their institutions, and that is not true. It's particularly not true in statistics. You have very strong programs at lower ranked universities. Not bad universities, just lower ranked universities, and vice versa. And so the two are obviously correlated, but they are not one-to-one rankings in terms of what the programs achieve versus what the university itself achieves. The best ways, in my opinion, to learn about these different programs, first of all, you have tons of resources here, and these are the faculty that are in ICS. They've spent their lives getting to know the individuals in these fields and the different programs. They think about this constantly. They know people at these places. So they're a number one resource of learning about this. They're obviously published rankings, but it's good to get a personal point of view. The other thing is you do need to do a little bit of homework. I constantly get around application season people cold calling me and asking me about the department. That's a good thing. I'm happy to talk about it. I'm happy to talk about what our philosophies are, how we treat graduate students, what the outcomes of graduate students are, whether it be master's or PhD. So that's the quick answer.
So my question is, what do we look for in making admissions decisions? And again, it gets back to what kind of program you're applying to. And many universities now have two master's programs as well, a professional master's and a research-oriented master's. So the research master's is a little bit in between a professionally oriented master's degree and a PhD. So for PhD and other research-oriented programs, the GPA, the GRE, and the letters matter a lot, especially the letters, in addition to those other two. Typically in master's programs, the GPA and the GRE are the primary methods of evaluation, and part of that is just because of the number of applications that those programs will get. And then studying for the GRE does improve your scores, particularly your math scores, but probably the verbal scores as well. And in computer science anyway, that quantitative score matters a lot. So it's worth taking the time. And then one last thing, are publications needed? They're helpful. Research experience is helpful. It is not required. But if you want to do a PhD, it's a great idea to get some of that experience.
My question is, who should I get to write my letters? I say there are two factors. One is how well your letter writer knows you, and the second is how well your letter writer is known by the places you're applying for. And I'd say they're ranked in that order of importance. It's much better to have a letter from somebody who maybe isn't as well known, but really knows you well. And particularly if you're looking at a PhD application, they should know something about why you want to get a PhD. It's more than just what your grade was in the classes you took. You want to find out, you want to make sure they understand why you want to get a degree that focuses on research. And that's why it's important to get to know some faculty really well. I think the weakest letter you can have is from a very famous person for whom you got an A in a course of 200. That's almost worthless.
Question I have is, can I really get paid to go to graduate school? Yes, it's true. I think even all of us sitting here, I think we got paid during our graduate school and getting our PhD. There are various ways you're getting paid. I would say I can categorize them in three. Maybe as a, one is as a TA-ship and grader, basically helping as instructors in classes. And one is the other one, which should be a primary one, is basically through graduate research assistantship, which is basically your salary and your financial support comes from the grants that the advisor has received and you're working on that research project. And also, there are also fellowships that are basically, these fellowships might be belong to an institution, or there are also fellowships that are independent institutions, like NSF fellowships, that once you get that, you can apply, when you get admission from any university, you can actually use that fellowship. So there are various sources you can look into to basically get paid. My personal opinion, I think, is if you have a graduate research assistantship, is one of the best one, because you know, you're working on the project that is funded, and you also get paid in return. And there's a mutual interest between advisors and the group to get the project done, so it's more productive and is also, you know, you get paid. And I think throughout the PhD, since it's a long, you know, period of time, maybe 5 years, 6 years, usually students get paid various ways. It's not that you're gonna be GSR all 6 years. There are some quarters you're gonna be TA, some quarters, you know, you might have fellowships, and some that you don't, you know, you don't necessarily working for that, or you get a graduate student research assistantship through the grants. So it's really a combination of these three various resources, type of resources, that you can cover your expenses. For master's programs, it's a little bit harder. So usually when you get admission, it doesn't come with financial support. But many times you can apply for TA-ship, and maybe you can, you know, advisors have some, you know, short-term budget for from the grants that they wanted to do a small project with them. The research-based master's program, for example, can come from that, and you can get partially or fully paid, but there is no guarantee on that.
So my question is, what do the very top tier schools look for, and that overlaps heavily with what Professor Reagan was talking about. What are they? You know, what do you look for in making decisions? So it's basically the same answer. GPA and GRE and sort of a first cut, specifically the analytical part of the GRE. But the letters are really important. And I would say, what do I want? You want research, right? Evidence that you did research. So if you did research, evidence would be your letters, right? You get a letter from the person you did research with, and they say this person did great research. Because remember, like, especially with the PhD program, the whole thing is research. Like, that's the whole point. So if you did it before you got there and they know you do it well, then they're much more likely to admit you. So research in some form, papers, publications, those are great. Right, because that's what you have to do in grad school. You do research and then you publish a paper on it, right? So if you, the more that you did and sort of proved as an undergrad, the more likely they are to admit you.
Okay, so finally, the last question is, what about interdisciplinary options? So, you know, computer science these days is like mathematics was a few decades ago. And it's really almost impossible to do a research in universities these days that does not involve computers in some way or another. So there are some programs that are set up explicitly between different academic units in their universities. So we have a few here at UCI between the computer science and the biological sciences. And so they are formally interdisciplinary in the sense that they have components that are going in one academic unit and then components that are going on in another academic unit. And I think those can be very good. But as usual, you should get information about them, because some of these interdisciplinary programs may be a little harder to do than the non-interdisciplinary programs, because you're basically answering to two sets of professors. So it's better if you really find out exactly and talk to people who have gone through the program and find more information on how well the program actually works and whether it works well.
So I'm now going to ask the panel to discuss among themselves, and to simplify the pain of passing the mic, I think we'll start on that end this time and pick one topic and elaborate on it a little bit and then pass the mic. And it doesn't have to be your topic, it can be something someone else said too.
Okay, so why go to graduate school? Well, that's sort of, I think that's the big question. Everything else is details. Why would you go to graduate school? So I think Sandy, Professor Irani already said that probably financial compensation should probably not be the main motivation. So if you want to go to grad school, you want to do it because you really are curious and you want to pursue some intellectual activity that it's very unlikely that you are able to pursue those intellectual activities when you are working in industry. So that should be the main reason. It's intellectual curiosity and not the financial gains. And another thing that I see a lot of students coming into graduate school, especially in computer sciences and software engineering, there's sort of a fuzzy line between, you know, startups and kind of cool design ideas and research. And in some programs are more amenable to kind of design research than others. Others are more amenable to sort of more the scientific side of academia. So be aware that when you go into an academic program, a PhD program, you're very likely expected to do more of the scientific research than of kind of design kind of research that you could do probably in a startup environment, for example, or on your own, on your basement or something. So the emphasis is really sort of kind of trying to think deep about certain problems and try to formulate those problems really well, and preferably in a way that haven't been formulated before. And the formulation of problems many times is the most important part of research, and then hopefully come up with interesting solutions too. But and then the argumentation that goes into investigating that's what really is the juice of a doctoral program.
Great, thank you very much.
Okay, so to add on to that, research is really important. PhD is all about doing research, and by research I mean actually new stuff that's never been done before. Not just marginally, you know, I made a new product or something, but something that's like crazy. So for instance, maybe you want to take a description of a program, of what a program should do, and then from that English statement you automatically write a program, right? That is not done, right? That would be research, right? There's something that's really weird and out there that you have to want to do that. And one thing that comes along with that is that, you know, it's very, it can be very discouraging and tedious, okay? So in order to do a thing like that, you gotta read every single paper that's ever been written in the world about related topics, which takes years. This is why PhD takes years, right? You take years doing that. Then you think of your idea, and you try it, and you fail. And you spend a few more months, and you fail again, right? And then you're feeling hopeless because you spent months, and you threw it all away, right? And then you drop out, right? That happens, right? So it's a lot that happens. You just have to be able to just keep doing it anyway. For, I don't know, maybe it's a bad idea, but you know, you do it and you push through, or you know, at some point you make a decision to move to a new topic or something, people will have more comments. But remember that grad school is, especially PhD, is all about research, and if you don't like it, don't do it. Okay. Because you'll be sad, right? And you should try it as an undergrad, you should try it. Right? Not only just to see if you want to even do it in grad school, but also to get a letter of recommendation, right? That's how you get a letter. How's a professor ever gonna know you from office hours? Unlikely, right? They're gonna know you from doing research with them, so you should do research.
Thank you.
So regarding applications and when you applied for graduate school, so you decided you want to do PhD, is it a good idea to contact professors and institutions that you're applying to let them know that you're interested in the type of research they're doing or not? It's a good idea to do that, given that you know there are so many, several hundreds of applications we get, and we have to go through that. So it's very easy. We slip through, or we don't notice some details. So sometimes emailing your professor, which, you know, his research is of your interest, so sort of, you know, can, you know, bring the attention of that professor to what you are good at. But don't write a generic email to the professors. Dear professor, this, it's very generic. I'm applying. I like your research very much. I'm very interested, and I looked at your papers. I like this paper titled this, presented at this. So you can tell, oh, it's from the homepage. It's just things getting copy-pasted. And sometimes you make mistakes, and I see, oh, my colleague's name or somebody else's paper is there because you're sending to hundreds of people. I do not reply to those emails. I just drop them because I think there's no interest. So make sure if you're emailing, you have a reasons, and it's your personal reasons, your passion, more than what I like about the paper he has done is what you have done that you want. You can make that professor excited about, or your vision or your understanding of the problem, you know, the topics that you think is it might be of his interest as well, and sort of, you know, excite him to write you back.
Great.
So we get several hundred emails like that.
We get a lot of emails, dear sir, addressed to me. So yeah, those get deleted.
I get that too.
Dear Professor Lathrop, I'm excited about doing research with you at the University of Texas, Austin.
Texas.
A couple of comments. One is, while the PhD is, to get a PhD, you have to do original research, as has been stressed by several people. The PhD is often a required degree for lots of different careers. I mean, obviously, to be a university professor, even at a more teaching-oriented college, you have to have a PhD, and a lot of jobs in industry require a PhD and so on. So it can be the path to a lot of different kinds of careers, not just a career in research. I want to follow up on something Amelia mentioned about that master's degrees come in two flavors, a research degree and a professional degree. I spent the majority of my career at the University of Michigan and was part of the development of the School of Information, which stressed professional master's programs in a variety of different areas, including the areas that I'm in. And I did a lot of teaching in that area. And the career placement of people with professional master's degree was extremely excellent. People were getting jobs at all kinds of top places. And so that's another interesting path to consider.
Thank you.
Let's see, I heard a lot of good things. So yeah, I hope that Ian wasn't discouraging. So,
no, people think research, they're like, oh, this is cool, I wanna do this. There's a lot of hard work and years of hard work behind that, and you should know that.
All I was gonna say is that most of us start out by doing research sort of with a small R. So we make small contributions, and we publish a few sort of minor papers, and then maybe we get warmed up and we do tackle bigger and more interesting and harder problems. So it's a process, just like learning to be a student is a process. I was gonna address one thing that, question is, should you take some time off before you go to graduate school? So most of us here went straight through, but I took 5 years off. I did get a master's degree in applied math in those 5 years while I was working. But I felt like working in industry, being a software developer, you know, working on real systems prepared me for graduate school in a way I never would have been prepared without that experience. So you can't go back. There's some difficulties, like if you own a house or if you get married, you have children, there are some complications later that you don't have now. But you can also grow up and be a lot ready to tackle those challenges later on.
Thank you.
I just wanted to elaborate on one thing that I had said earlier and then maybe bring up an additional comment. You know, the first thing is, I just wanted to relay a personal story. You know, I talked about speaking to your ICS faculty here about where you should be thinking about applying, the types of fields you should consider. You know, they are a great resource. If you're lucky enough to have a mentor, so when I was an undergrad, I can remember going into Professor Jay DeBoer's office. I'd done my homework, I thought, and I'd had a list of places I was going to apply, and he said, oh, Dan, that's great, I'm glad you came and talked to me. He said, we'll start off this week, and we'll meet for the next couple of weeks, you know, for an hour, and we'll talk about the different aspects of individuals that I know at these places. The upshot of that is when I actually went to apply for graduate school, at about 80% difference between what I started with and where I ended up applying. And it was for the better, because I learned about these different places from someone that knew individuals at those places. and it was great. And so that really kind of changed the direction of my graduate career, to be quite honest. The second thing I wanted to say is, you know, there are different cultures depending upon the type of program that you apply for, and this pertains mostly to PhD, but I can imagine it applies to master's students as well. So statistics is where I come from. It's generally the culture that we admit PhD students to the department. We don't admit PhD students to a particular advisor to work on a specific research project. Some places are different, okay? You will be applying largely to an advisor. And so you need to think about that when you're writing the application and also choosing the program. You know, if you're applying in a statistics department because you think, oh, this person X is here, so I'm going to apply there, that doesn't guarantee that you're going to be working with person X, okay? It just doesn't happen. So you want to get to know that situation, talk to person X and see if that's going to be a likely possibility, et cetera, if you're making that decision. And then the last thing I do want to say, because something came up about quantitative GRE scores, in statistics, for us, communication is absolutely key. That personal statement, we read very carefully. So we usually do a triage on GREs and things like that, but we read personal statements very carefully. We read letters from individuals talking about communication abilities, writing abilities. A big part, even if you're doing a technical dissertation, you have to be able to communicate it. You have to be able to write, okay? And so we really take that seriously when we're looking at applications.
Thank you.
All right, so to elaborate a little bit on the master's, I think a lot of us, our comments were focused on the PhD programs, partly because that's where our hearts are. And while I said that, you know, financial incentive is not necessarily the right reason to go into research, it's actually not a bad reason to get a professional master's degree. You can really improve your standing in a company, the kinds of jobs you can get, and your income. It's, you know, a professional master's is a little bit more of a specialized version of what you're doing now as an undergraduate, just more classwork. That being said, the role of a more research-oriented master's can be a nice stepping stone to graduate school. It may be difficult in a program like UCI, where the numbers are so big and faculty time is so limited, to get into a lab, to get the background that you need, to get that fantastic letter that gets you into graduate school. So a research-oriented master's can be a stepping stone to do that, because we use ours as a way to kind of test the waters with different students. So a lot of those students end up then getting entrance into the PhD program if they perform well, okay? And in a master's program, you're gonna have a little bit more access to faculty. You'll get a sense more of what research is like and if it's a good fit for you, because you don't really know that taking classes. And that way you'll have a better opportunity to make a good impression to get admissions into graduate school. So that can be another vehicle to get entrance. Because I know that, you know, faculty time is limited, and when you have 200 students in your class, you just can't accommodate that many students in your lab at the undergraduate level. So. And one more thing, the importance of letters. The reason that they matter so much is that your grades as an undergraduate are not necessarily the best indicator of whether you're going to succeed in graduate school. We have typically an attrition rate of about 50% in our PhD program, and that's standard, just because students don't know if they're suited for it, and faculty don't know if the incoming people are going to be good at it. It's not a sure thing. It's very different than taking classes. And so if you have a letter from someone that you know saying this person can think like a researcher, that counts so much more than grades, because that's really sort of ultimately what we're looking for.
Great, thank you.
So I'll make a couple of brief comments. Amelia mentioned, is it okay not to go straight through? For myself, I worked for a year after I finished my undergraduate, and then I went around the world for a year. And then I entered graduate school at the MIT Artificial Intelligence Lab, and that worked very well for me. The thing to do if you're going to take some time off is ask your professors to write the letters now while you're still fresh in their mind and they know all the good things about you, and just keep them on file till you're ready to submit, first. And second, don't plan on being out for more than 2 years. You get a wife, a mortgage, kids, used to a good salary, a good job, and it gets really hard to go back. With that, I'm going to open the floor to general questions from the audience. Feel free to address them to a specific professor if you like, or the panel in general. And for the panelists, I'm going to run back and forth behind you with the mic, so raise your hand when you want the mic. Questions from the floor?
So I'm a senior.
Nice, loud, booming, outdoor voice.
So I'm a senior, and so I I guess, kind of recently started considering going to graduate school, and so I was just wondering if, how exactly would I go about starting to get research experience or letters of recommendation? Like, I guess this includes like people who just recently graduated as well. Like, how would they sort of go about getting research experience or getting letters of recommendation?
Well, I think if you recently graduated and you haven't had research experience, you're probably not going to be getting research experience. You're probably going to be getting work experience and applying. Hopefully you will have connected with some of your faculty. It's not that you can ask for letters now. It's not that you can never get a letter of recommendation from somebody in industry, but you need to have at least one or probably two from faculty members. So you should try to get to know people now. And then another question I had for you is, are you considering a PhD program or a master's program?
Either or, like, I was just wondering.
Yeah, so I mean, you wouldn't be disadvantaged applying to master's programs even without research experience, but it would be a little different for PhD.
I had one of my own letter writers be one of my supervisors from industry, but you have to coach them on the intellectual and things that will get you into graduate school. I made a history of asking for letters of recommendation just for my file. Some of them from industry say things like, his attendance is perfect. His grammar is impeccable. That'll get you a job, but it won't get you into graduate school.
Can I just go ahead?
Dan first and then Christina.
I just wanted to make one comment on the research aspect because, you know, it's kind of late right now. I would say, you know, that shouldn't preclude somebody to applying to even PhD programs, okay? I mean, it certainly doesn't hurt when you're ranking graduate students. But we admit, again, I'm coming from statistics, but we admit multiple individuals coming from a bachelor's degree that haven't had formal research training. Okay, they have strong letters, they have clear kind of documentation that they're doing well in the types of foundational courses that we're looking for. So, I mean, you shouldn't be discouraged, I don't think, from applying if you don't have research experience, and certainly from my experience.
Thank you.
So, yeah, I have a feeling that your situation is probably common, very common here. Because it's like you're seeing the end of your program coming, and then like, oh my God, what do I do now? I really have to go get a job. I was in exactly the same situation as you were. I went to grad school because the other options were not as good, you know, not because I had sort of a drive in the beginning to actually go and do science, right? So it was something, the appeal for research was something that probably, maybe it was already in me, but I actually didn't know, but it definitely grew. In grad school, I learned to actually enjoy intellectual freedom and kind of the ability to go out and search for problems. But so, I mean, in your situation, what Dan said, you shouldn't be discouraged from applying directly to a PhD program, but you probably want the stepping stone of a master's degree and probably a research-oriented master's degree so that you actually know what research is about. And you know, maybe it's for you, maybe it's not for you. A PhD is a very big commitment. It's like a 5-6 year commitment out of your life, you know. Especially for women, for the women here, it's not like only the men who get wives and houses. The women probably also are thinking about having children at this particular phase of their lives. And it may lead you to delay that, or you know, there are many graduate students, female graduate students who actually have children during their PhD program. It's not unheard of. It makes life a lot harder, but you know, some people actually like to have life made harder for them and do really well. So,
other questions from the audience? Yes, please.
So it's kind of two parts. The first part would be, for a PhD, how strongly would I need to know what kind of field of computer science I'd be going into grad school? And then the second part that relates to that is, if I need to know, oh, I want to study algorithms in grad school for a PhD, or if I want to do artificial intelligence, how strong does it matter if that research was related to that, or does it just shows that I can do research in something and later on I could gear towards something else?
Would the panel please repeat the question?
I think the question was, when I'm applying for a graduate school PhD program, I believe,
yeah.
How important it is that I specifically know what kind of what category of research topics I want to do. And
yeah.
If I happen to do research in a specific area, but I don't want to stick to it necessarily. Do I have an option of exploring other research areas when I'm applying?
And how much does my research in undergrad have to be related?
Does it have to be related to research they do? That's a very good question. I think any type of research in any area you do is indication of your interest to looking at some unsolved problems, taking the challenge and finding a solution. So even if the research topic is not related, but if I see, you're doing some research in AI and I'm looking at embedded system, for example, but say with your background and your statement of purpose, you have indicated why you're interested in embedded systems, for example. For me, I would look into this, if you have done this project very successfully and I can see your strength from that project too. So for example, I can see, you have some strength in algorithms or developing softwares. So now you come to my group, you can develop softwares not for AI, but maybe for embedded systems. I can see your strength, your interests, some of it necessarily, and I think we will be open in, the project that you pick. I think if you do a research in a specific project, but you want to be open to different areas, I think you have to write your statement of purpose in a way that shows that that's not the only area you're looking at, or a couple of other areas looking. If you're really not sure what area you want to go to, then I think maybe master's program could be better, because in master's program, the courses that we have and everything is more, of course you pick your concentration in some institutions and some others don't necessarily ask you to do that, but you can have explorations of taking, you have this opportunity to take master's level courses in different topics, maybe in the first year, and then you can take in more in depth in a specific area that you want to concentrate. For PhD, I think most of the applications that we get are more focused, are more determined. It's more clear what they want to do, and they have a research background in that topic. But I don't think that would doing research, successful research in another topic would take you its negative impact on you applying to another area. It's good you could do something, but if you do your homework, understanding the other research project and statement of your purpose, you provide that in your interview with the faculty who's interested in what you want to do. Sometimes they do Skype interview with you and other things, because they might look more into details more than other applications, because, let me see, is this really a right fit? Then, I don't think it's negative.
Okay, thank you. And Gary.
Just to amplify that, I agree that doesn't really matter. Sometimes when you get research experience as an undergraduate, it's kind of an accident of circumstances that you happen to fall into some situation. So I think just showing that you are interested in research, independent of what area, can be important. Also, at least in the good programs, you may come thinking you want to work on topic A, but you find out about topics B and C while you're in school, and you end up doing topic C as your dissertation. That's a very common path for a lot of students.
Thank you. Another question from the audience. Yes, please.
Ask about the GRE score.
Louder, please.
GRE score.
GRE score?
Yeah. Is it
important?
Who wants to handle that?
What's the question?
Minimum GRE score for all the
schools have different.
Well, it's different. So most of the PhD students, I know the median GRE scores on the math section of the GRE for both master's and PhD was the highest score you can get, the median score of the people we accepted, which is 94%, 94th percentile. So it's very important, at least in computer science, that you do very well on that. And you can do very well on that, you just have to practice. But there's no minimum, there's no perfect minimum. In terms of the verbal scores, we know that there's not a perfect correlation between verbal skills and verbal scores, but if you're an American student, and English is your first language, you should be paying a lot of attention to those scores, because if they're really terrible, then it means you probably can't write. And so, for the foreign students, it differs from where you're from and all that. It's not a perfect correlation, but you really should practice so you do well in GREs, but you should have a very high math GRE score to get into a good computer science program.
Another question from the audience? Yes, please.
what's the difference if the end goal that I have is to get a PhD? Is there any time where it would be recommended to go from a master's to a PhD or for just straight into a PhD program?
I can take that.
So if you can get into
Could you repeat the question, please?
So the question is, what's the typical progression from a master's to a PhD, or do you go straight into a PhD program? Many of us go straight into a PhD program. So if you can get into a PhD program that you like, that's a good program and a good fit for you, go for it. You don't need a master's to do that. And typically when you're in the PhD program, when you finish your classwork, somewhere along the way you get a master's, you know? And so when I said we had a 50% attrition rate, those students typically leave with a master's degree. So they have something to show for the time that they spent. We do have students coming in with master's degrees. Sometimes they're in a slightly different field and they're making this jump over to computer science. You know, sometimes they're switching schools because they want to do a PhD with someone else and they've learned about a new area. But if you're already admitted in a PhD program, there's no kind of distinction about when your master's ends. I mean, you just kind of sort of, you finish your coursework and you start doing research from there.
Great, thank you. Another, yes please.
Can you apply to both the school's master's and PhD program to better your chances of getting into a school?
I want to take that.
So I don't think you can
Could you repeat the question, please?
The question is, can you apply to the master's and PhD simultaneously? I don't understand exactly why this is, because you can apply to two different programs in a university, including in ours. But usually you would apply to a one, and then, for example, if you know there's a university you want to go to, you can ask them, will I be accepted in the PhD? Do you think I'll be accepted? And if you get an answer that's no, you could then ask them, can I change my application to master's? It might be too late at some places, but we often will contact students who apply for the PhD who seem well qualified but aren't going to get accepted into that very small pool to see if they want to do a master's.
Thank you. Another question from the audience? Yes, at the back, please.
What's the exact step to go through a PhD program without getting master's? What's the exact step?
Could you repeat that a little bit louder, please?
What's the exact steps to go for a PhD program, to apply for a PhD program without getting master?
So administratively, it's trivial. You just have to send the applications in the fall, I guess, right? It's in the fall that you guys all send your applications all over. So administratively, it's completely trivial. You just do your GREs and send submissions to whatever programs you want. But there's more than just the paperwork, right? There's also your own preparation and your chances of getting accepted in those programs. And that requires a little bit more forethought. So if you think that graduate school is in your radar, the sooner you kind of put that as a possibility, the better chances you have of actually getting in, because you will be able to get involved with research in your local school wherever you are. If you are a third year student, that's probably the best time to get awareness that you might end up in grad school, because you still have time. You still have about a year, 6 months to get involved in some research project getting a taste of what that is about, and then you really have good chances if you do well, you know, and if you like it. If you're a senior student and then just suddenly you realize, oh, okay, maybe I should go to grad school, it's not too late. It's perfectly fine. As I said, that's what happened to me. But it's possible. You should do it, and you just apply and hope that the letters of recommendation are strong enough.
Great. Thank you. Another question? Oh, yes, please.
Just adding to what Chrissy says, I agree with her. When you apply as undergrad, so even if it's your senior year, like you don't really have that opportunity to really involve yourself in research. You know, if you have a very strong GPA, especially in the core courses of the areas that you're interested to do research, and the letters indicate that, and, you know, somehow, I think what is missing, if you somehow in that research are able to get close to some faculties that they know you, not just, you know, got a good grade in their class, that they can actually emphasize in their letters that, as they said, why you like to go to PhD in this area, and why he thinks you are really suitable for that area because of your strength in this specific topic or this project you had in the class with him. You did something extraordinary, you solved that specific problem differently, you know, things like that also can help the application fresh from undergrad to PhD. But yeah, I mean, it's not, you can always give it a try, but look at in that aspect that how it can, because you're applying along with other master students who have some research and everything, so you have to somehow show that you also have the same potential like others.
Thank you. We have time for one final question for the faculty. Yes, please.
A question about interdisciplinary fields. If I wanted to do something like computational physics, but I'm a computer science major, would it be best to do a second bachelor's or a double major, or would I, could I still apply anyway and would just be required to take the classes that I'm missing?
Thank you. Computational physics probably sits more inside physics than
could
it does
you,
in computational
repeat,
physics. So he asked about computer science, the interdisciplinary programs, and whether that's going to span to different departments. You want to do a little, you know, a little background research on where that normally sits inside of a university. So computational physics probably is going to sit more inside a physics department than a computer science department. And your background in physics is going to be more critical for admission to graduate school. Other fields are different. We have computational biology in-house here in computer science, and they work closely with biologists in other fields. So it really varies for the specific area, and that information you'll best get from talking to faculty.
With that, we're going to draw the faculty panel to a close and move to the graduate student panel. And I'm going to shoo the faculty out so that the students can speak freely. Please join me in thanking the faculty for their work. So we now turn to the part of the program where current UCI graduate students will first explain what they did to get into UCI and how they made a successful application and take more of your floors. Could we begin by passing the microphone down and just introduce yourselves and say a little bit about where you're from and what you're working on? Okay.
Hello, hi. So my name is Ankita. I'm a PhD student in the informatics department, and I guess I'm here now. I've been here for 5 years, my first 2 years for a master's, and then I transferred, so that's a fun thing that I'll talk about later. And I work with Bill Tomlinson and Deborah Richardson doing work in environmental informatics and software engineering.
Hi, my name is Sen Hirano. I'm a fifth year PhD student in the Department of Informatics here. I've been here for a while. I did my undergraduate here and then I continued on. I'm doing my dissertation on understanding how to help teach and direct novices as they're cooking, and so doing that through both understanding the human side and also figuring out how we can technologically support them through like sensors and such.
Hi, I'm Brian Vigitabli. I'm in the Department of Statistics. I'm a third year PhD student, so just kind of getting into research. A lot of my stuff is more in Bayesian statistics and want to focus in machine learning a little bit. My advisor is Hal Stern, but I've got a different background than a lot of other people. I spent a lot of time in industry before coming back, so hopefully I can give some other perspectives on that.
I'm Donnie. I'm a third year PhD student. I work with Professor Dutt in embedded systems and computer science. And I came here, so this is my third year. I came in with a master's from another school, so hopefully like a unique perspective.
Hi, my name is Luann. I'm a second year PhD student in informatics, and I spent 20 years in between my master's and coming back to school. I started as a behavior analyst working for kids with autism, and now I'm doing assistive technology for kids with autism with Dr. Jillian Hayes.
Thank you very much. And now I'm going to pass the mic back down, and I'd like each of you to take about 2-3 minutes and say what you consider was the single most important thing you did to make your application successful, and what would be the most important thing you could tell these students to help them make a successful application.
Research. Okay, in 3 minutes though. So like I said, I had already been involved in industry. I'm a behavior analyst working in the field and became increasingly interested in research. And so over the course of 10 years, I actually met Sen way back when he was doing a research project in one of my schools, and I as over time, when I realized the value of research, I got more and more involved and contacted Dr. Hayes to see what would be involved. And what she said to me was, you've been out of school so long, why would you do this to yourself? And I'm like, I really, really want to do research. And she's like, how do you know? I mean, you've been out of school so long. How do you really know? And I said, let me do it. So I had been involved with a bunch of projects over, like I said, 10 years, where I was a community collaborator. And so as I started to think about a PhD, she said, well, why don't you take on a project as the primary person in the project? And because I had an initial research background, I felt comfortable doing that. And she let me run it. And it was kind of like a test. Like, is this what you want to do? And so I ran a study in the site where I worked. And of course, I was completely in love with it and actually had a hard time doing my regular work. I just wanted to do research. So going through that whole process, I actually finished an experimental study before I even decided to send in my application. So I had all that work under my belt, and I got to move forward with it, and it's now published. So I think having that exposure and then taking the lead to get involved as much as you can helps show that you have what it takes to kind of do research.
So I think if you just are interested in getting a master's, is this for PhD students only? Or
it's for both.
Both, all right. If you just want a master's, get good grades, get good test scores, and get good letters. I mean, it's pretty straightforward. If you want a PhD, it's a whole different ballgame, I think. You should establish, I would highly suggest establishing like some type of dialogue with potential advisors, multiple, all of the ones you think you want to work for. Because that's all that really matters, much more than the program you're in or the school you're at. Your advisor is really important. So that's kind of what got me here. I found something in common with a potential advisor, and he was impressed enough to let me work for him. So yeah, impress your potential advisors, I would say.
So my background was in aerospace engineering, and worked in industry for 4 years and transitioned to statistics, so I really had to find a way to make my application stand out compared to all of the other math majors that were applying to statistics programs. So one of the things that was, I think, key in getting me here was interfacing with professors at UC Irvine, at Columbia, and just talking with these individuals on one-to-one basis. So if I could, I'd set up a Skype call with them and, you know, spend an hour talking about their programs, figuring out their areas of research, and seeing if that meshed with what I was interested in. Actually, I had a girlfriend at the time in California, so flew out and met with Porrick Smith here at UCI and talked with him about the machine learning program here. And I think one of the big strengths for me was just that networking and communication type skill. They talked about it in the beginning that, you know, it's, you really need to know that the person you're going to work with encompasses what you're going to do. That, I've been told afterwards, plays a huge factor in, you know, the closed door faculty meetings, that they've met you, they know you, and it's more than just an email. It's they've actually met you and see that your intentions are for their program. So that's what I would suggest for some of this.
So it's been a while. I'm trying to remember how this process worked. But I mean, they covered some decent topics already. If you're trying to go for a master's, like, depending on which master's program you're going in, I'd really urge you to check and see what kind of master's program you're going for. I mean, because a lot of people apply to UCI, to our informatics program, and think it's a professional master's, but really it's a research master's, and they have no idea what they got themselves into because it's totally different than what they wanted. For me, and trying to apply here, I feel like the relationship I started with my advisor in doing research early on, like, helped create this thing that we wanted to continue. I guess there's more I want to say about the program, but that's not quite the right time to do that. I guess also, so not only should you go and check out the people who has certain, or who does the work that you want to do, or you think you might want to do, or is in the context you want to do, but it's really important to try to talk to them, and if possible, try to meet them. Because the students I've seen, and also the professors I've seen, it's been most successful if there's also a personality match.
You really have to be able to get along well with your advisor because you're going to be stuck with them for a while. It's a long-term relationship that you have to try to get through.
So I'm actually an international student, and before coming to the States, I sort of didn't really have a very good sense for what the American university system was like. And I was also sort of generally a very enthusiastic person about everything, which is hard when you're finishing up undergrad and you want to do everything, and you have to try and now whittle down what that actually instantiates to, because that's a really strong part of applying to grad school, or even trying to figure out what you want to do next in your life. And so in the last sort of year, I was sitting in Fiji living with my parents, still finishing up my undergrad, and so I just decided to try a bunch of different things. So I took a machine learning course at the local university and did some research. I played around in open source communities. I like tried everything that I thought was interesting and something that I thought I wanted to do, which is really vague advice, I realized. But you know, I think many of you are in your final years, so you will have the time to at least sample a couple of different things. And then based on that process, I could whittle down what it was that I wanted to do. And granted, that's changed, and now I finally settled on something, but it allowed me to try and figure out what path I wanted to take. And so that allowed me to then approach random, random professors in the States saying, hey, these are the things I'm really excited about, and it seems that you're also excited about them too. Can we chat? And I sort of got lucky because it turns out that people are kind of open to those sorts of emails being sent to them. And that allows you to then get the conversation started of, okay, what does the program look like, the actual practicalities of grad school? So that, I think, in concert with everything that everyone has said so far, was sort of a good approach, I think.
Great, thank you all. And now I'm going to invite the panel to elaborate on what's been said or say anything else that you think would be useful. And we will use the mic, so just raise your hand when you want to talk, and I'll run back and forth real quick behind the panel and bring you the mic.
Just to touch on something a little bit more that one of these guys said, I don't know if it was Keaton, but yeah, whittling down what you want to do is important, right? Like having direction for your whatever you're going to spend years studying is important, and none of you are going to have it. So all the other things, I think, are very important to emphasize. Like, realistically, out of your first year out of your bachelor's, you're not going to have direction, probably, that someone else didn't give you. So these kind of dialogues, I think, to emphasize, like, you're going to be really vague in your statement of purpose, probably, right? Try to avoid stuff like that. Even if you have to fake it, have some type of direction that looks like you're at least narrowing your focus and field of study rather than broadening it, because that's what happens as you progress in grad school. You focus less and less on peripheral things and more on what one little contribution you're going to make.
Thank you.
So I guess one piece of advice is, if you don't know what you want to do, don't jump right into a program. I had my undergrad in aerospace engineering and left there going, I know graduate school is for me, I don't know what I want to study. So if I would have jumped into a program in a graduate program in aerospace engineering, I would have never finished. So I took some time, and you know, it ended up taking me 4 years to figure out exactly what I was passionate about and what I wanted to spend 5 years focusing on. But I think a lot of people just jump into the graduate program thinking that's the next step. I've done school for this long. I'm really good at school. Why not do 2 more years of it or 5 more years of it? And you can really convince yourself that these are going to be the things I'm going to study for the rest of my life. And sometimes actually going out into the world and seeing what else is out there can change your perspectives and actually highlight the things you are interested in. So if you don't know what you'd want to do, I think spend some time finding out what you want to do is good advice as well. So.
Yeah, I think the more you can hit the ground running, the better or more successful that you'll be, because I've seen a ton of people floundering the first few years trying to figure what they're out there trying to do. Mm-hmm. But also, it's not enough to kind of like the work. Like, if you've worked in hospitals or something, you kind of think you might want to do like medical informatics or something. But I guess speaking from my own personal experience, Like, I did like doing that work for a while, but then at a certain point, there were some roadblocks or things that I just didn't like about doing that kind of work, and so I transitioned off to something else. So I guess that would be, if you're not sure what you do, I would suggest trying to work or trying to do something to get some experience before then, but it really doesn't quite replace actually having some opportunity to do research in there and understand what it's like doing that kind of work, because if you're trying to get a PhD, you're really trying to do that because you want to do that work in the future. And if you find out you don't like doing that kind of work, then it's going to be a huge waste of time for you. I mean, as it is, a PhD is a huge waste of time if you don't want to do that kind of work. Like, there's no good reason to get a PhD if you're in for the money. Like people said, like, yeah. You're doing the wrong thing.
But there is something really fantastic about the PhD program, which is that it is the one opportunity, at least for me, the one opportunity that I've had in my life where I get to pretty much find problems that I think are interesting and then try and solve them. And this means that when you start, even though I started off by thinking I wanted to do X and I was really excited about doing X and I was like, this is what I'm going to do, things changed, I switched topics, and now I'm more excited about Y. And that's perfectly okay. And it's not that all of that time is wasted. I think in the faculty panel before, the gentleman over there was saying that it's a lot of hard work, things fail, and things fail again, and that's also part of this. You don't actually end up wasting anything because you build skills along the way. Every different kind of problem that you try and solve allows you to learn a new skill set. And so I figure, worst case scenario, if at the end of all of this it turns out I don't want to go into academia, I've still learned a whole bunch of skills that I can then take and apply in any domain that I work in. So in that sense, it's been 5 years of skills building and sort of being at a giant scientific playground. So that's the fun side of things.
So I was, to kind of add to the skills thing, I was just at a conference and they were talking on data science and all of these, you know, transitions between PhDs and academia and things like that. And the focus in the crowd was, you know, what is the difference between a master's student and a PhD student sometimes? And he said that the students he sees that come out in the PhD just have a different way of tackling problems and learning skill sets on their own. So kind of adding to that, in the 5 years, you will learn how to learn and figure out things all along the way. So it isn't, you will learn a lot in 5 years that isn't really your dissertation. So.
Right. Great, thank you.
Sorry.
Further comments from the panel?
I was just going to echo on what Sen said, like, make sure you have a purpose for doing it. Like, you will learn a bunch of skills, but at a master's you can do a lot of things. There's a lot of jobs you can have, and you certainly aren't necessarily going to make more money with a PhD, because I'm pretty sure I'm going to make less when I finish. But the difference is I'm really, really, really passionate about the work I'm going to be doing, and this is the only way I can get that skill set. So know what you want to do with it.
I think this is something that we've all touched on, which is the difference between the master's and the PhD program. I use the master's as a test to see if I enjoyed research, so I actually came in for a terminal master's program. And so maybe if you're unsure about whether or not you actually want to spend 5 years doing it, that might be a nice way of doing things. So then trying to figure out what kinds of programs, so the professional master's versus the master's by research, and then some of them have the integrated master's programs. Trying to figure out which one of these is most useful to you in the short term might also be a nice way of helping you figure out which programs to actually apply for.
Thank you.
To comment on that, I think ideally that's a good strategy, and Kita is a purist, I would say, but strategically, always apply for a PhD program, because then you might get funding, and in the worst case, you drop out if you don't like it and you have a master's.
This is true. I did TA for 2 years solid because I had no funding in my master's. So,
but there is still opportunity for funding. Like, there are ways you can get your master's funding.
There's not much of a downside if you're coming from a bachelor's.
The mic, please. The mic. We were warned people in the back can't hear us.
I tend to be generally loud, but there is, it's not that getting a master's is a bad idea, but I think if you're coming straight from an undergraduate, like straight out of your bachelor's, and you have the choice, one of the professors actually said this, and this was the case, this happened to me previously is if you apply for a PhD program, you might just get admitted to as a master's student anyway, only, right? If they think you have some value, but maybe you're not ready to do research yet.
Any further comments from the panel? At this point, I'd like to open the floor to general questions from the audience. And feel free to address it to the panel in general or to a specific member, as you prefer.
How has money worked out for all of you, particularly for a PhD? You mentioned funding, but how does that work? Do you need to take out loans at some point to pay for schooling?
I think I'll just start the microphone at this end and we'll go down and each one of you can address that question for yourself if you'd be so good.
So this is different for, I think, every single student based on the lab that you're working in and what kind of work you do. I've actually TA'd for the most part. So most of my funding has come through working as a teaching assistant. And then for a couple of years, I've also worked as a GSR, which is a graduate student researcher, for both labs within my department and also labs all across the university. And so some summers I went to like a civil engineering group and I worked IT support and data cleaner essentially for them, right? So I was basically just like helping them with server administration. And so that sort of work has helped me pay my bills. I don't know how typical this is because I guess my lab doesn't have any large grants. And so it's been a lot of sort of like small pots of money here and there. But I have never gone hungry, so that's a plus. And I like pizza.
Yeah, so you can go to a bunch of these events and get free pizza too. When I came in, my funding's been fairly mixed. My first year, I was paid as GSR. Like my advisor had enough funds on the project we were working on. So there's different ways in which money can fall into your lap. Your advisor can have a grant for a project in which they can use money from that to fund you. You can get a fellowship, which you apply to something, and then they'll give you somewhere between 1 to 4 years of funding, maybe in addition to or just in addition to whatever else other funding you get, or just by itself. And so when I got here, I got the NSF GFRP, which you should all apply for if you're thinking about being a PhD. You have to be American, and the deadline is next week. So, good luck. But I've also TA'd here, and I've taught classes, which you've also done. And so actually right now I'm transitioning off of my fellowship onto the normal GSR stipend, which you can also apply for small little fellowships, and so they give you some money in addition to, you just got one of those. But all of these different pots are things that can be easy and give you different varying levels of income, and so like we've been fairly vague. But so it's in general, at least in my department that I've seen, people have gotten somewhere between like 1,300 to about 1,900 or 2K a month. I'm not sure how typical that is, but I know in some other programs that's less. When I was on my fellowship, I think I got like 2,600 a month. And I think as a TA, it varies, but I think you get around like 1,500 to 1,700 a month. Although when I was teaching my class, at least over the summer, that was actually pretty bad. Like, I don't know if as undergrads you've ever paid attention or seen how much people actually make, but like I only got paid like $4,000 to teach the entire summer. So, I mean, it's often people think that like as a lecturer or a TA, like we're in the like entire priority, but like we're actually not paid. The time that we're paid isn't actually a huge portion of the time that we were spending teaching you, so that changes how you see some of these things.
So as Dan Gillen pointed out earlier in the Department of Statistics, we come into the department, so our department has funded us. We're guaranteed funding through our 5 years. So we come in and we're told that we'll have funding, whether it be through a readership, a TA,
anything. They'll make sure something's there for us. I mean, you do have to work for it. I've been lucky enough to transition to a GSR now, and you know, my teaching load has gone down quite a bit since then, but you look for the opportunities that you can get, and you hope that someone really likes you and wants to make your life a little bit easier, so it can all work out. So
these guys have mostly talked about kind of just playing your odds and showing up, but the kind of money you want is guaranteed money.
Yeah.
So again, like any good long-term relationship, yours with your advisor, you should talk about money for sure. This should be like, shouldn't be some unspoken topic or something. Like, have an open dialogue again about money before you show up, right? To ask them what grants they have and what their prospects look like in the future. They might be on an NSF expedition and they're rich for 5 years and then you'll never have to worry about it. Or you might have to TA for 4 years, but that's again something that might not be guaranteed. So you shouldn't pay for anything during your PhD. And if you're not getting that impression from whoever your advisor is going to be, that's, I think, a bad relationship and working environment. So figure it out up front. Be very upfront about like what this money situation is. And again, going back to things like the NSF and all these third-party fellowships that you can apply for on your own, it's actually a great part of an application or as a prospective student, something to come in with your at least some of your own money and say, it's just, you know, another bonus on your application, kind of sets you apart from other people. It's a pretty prestigious award, or a lot of them are because they're competitive. So that's a good thing. Apply for anything you can on your own, because if nothing else, it's impressive. And summers are kind of a crapshoot, but other than that, you should be taken care of. And I guess that's it. Talk about it.
Yeah, I agree with everything they said. So when they say everything's paid for, you're on a scholarship, so your classes are paid for. You still have to buy your books. but then to pay to live, so that's the stipend they're talking about, to pay to cover your apartment and your groceries. And the range that Sen gave you is what our lab uses, and that's accurate. And if I were 20 years younger and single, I could make it on that. But I'm not. I have a family, and so I did take out a loan, a student loan, which was ironic because they asked for my parents' signatures, and that was a little uncomfortable, so I didn't need them. I just signed for myself. I have a small loan, which I expect I can pay off relatively quickly. And like you said, summers are kind of up in the air. That's the only kind of guessing part that I have. And of course, you're free to do internships that generally do pay well. I would agree with you to definitely talk about it with your advisor. That was probably the longest conversations I had. Like, how am I going to do this? Yeah.
If I may just add on to the things the last two folks said, apply for fellowships, the large ones. There are Google fellowships, there are Facebook fellowships, there are so many large, amazing fellowships out there. If I could have sort of gone back and given myself advice 3 years ago when I was starting my PhD, or 4 years ago, that's what I would have done. I would have focused more on actually applying for these, because I was like, oh, teaching experience will be great for me, and it's good for me, but actually it would have been nice if I had like two more years of just GSR work where I could focus on the research. And so make sure that you're constantly looking out for the larger pots of money. My example is a terrible example. Don't do that. just as a note.
And I think let's just pass it down again, and if you have anything to add on, this is an important topic, and I'm sure you want to hear it.
Definitely like talk to your advisor about money. Like most of the people that I know have been told that we don't have to worry about money. It'll come somehow. Whether like they'll find some pot for you, or like they'll get you a TA ship, and it'll be settled. But yes, like having the various standards of living is important in understanding whether or not you'll need a loan. But at least for most of the people that I've seen, we have been fine with that. And at least so is us being in ICS as a greater community. We're fortunate enough where we can get paid internships that'll really give you more money than you've earned the rest of the year combined. So those can be fantastic experiences and such, but it also can be very distracting from your thing, but they can also be nice, right? So
depending on where you've taken them in your career, they can be really nice and helpful.
Yeah, I was just going to say, internships, as long as your advisor is amenable to it, you can double your salary in the summer. So, and you, if you set it up correctly and you go to, you know, the right place, you can actually pull some papers out of it as well. So if you, you aim for places like Microsoft Research or Yahoo Labs, and you really aim for the higher end internships, they'll pay you well and you'll get papers out of it. So, you know, this kind of goes with applying for fellowships, like apply for internships. Find ways to really put yourself out there and get the best chances to have a better life during grad school, because it's a long 5 years. So, yeah.
You don't need that much pizza.
And all those third-party fellowships that Kina mentioned pay better than the department will. So that's another motivation to get them. Internships are okay, but I'd say the same thing. I mean, they're a good idea to pad your bank account, but going same thing with teaching is when you've been TAing every quarter for 3 years and you realize you actually have like direction in your thesis, and then you have to spend 10 hours grading a midterm, it gets like pretty tiring. Same thing with internships, like these distractions you realize can add up. So getting like a source of money that is essentially encouraging you to spend time focusing on what you think is important is really a nice luxury.
I would say the same thing exactly. When I sold this gig to my husband, I'll make the money up in the summer. And he was actually fine with me going to the Bay Area or wherever. He's like, sure, I'll watch the kids, go make the money. And then as we got closer to it, one, I didn't want to leave the kids, but two, I didn't want to leave my research. Like, I really didn't want to stop and go do something else and have to buy new socks and all the things you have to do when you're in a new town. So yeah, so get the, apply for grants.
Well, that was an important topic, and I thank the panel for covering it very well. At this time, more questions from the audience? Yes, please.
Did any of you have a lot of burnout from your undergraduate degree, and did the graduate degree help fix that, or did taking time off help fix it, or what would you guys say if someone had, because they have a lot of burnout from their
I think we'll just start the microphone down. The question is about what did you do about burnout from your undergraduate degree, and how did that affect you? And
I went to work for 20 years. yeah, I actually, the job I started paid for a master's, so I got a master's and worked full-time and went to school full-time at night and had that paid for that way. And then after that, I was burned out. I wasn't ready to go back to school. And so I worked for another 15 years. And then now I'm not burned out anymore. So I guess it's taking your time and kind of knowing what you're passionate about and how you want to spend that time will drive what decisions you make.
Sorry. So if you don't mind, I could take a minute to tell you my story. I took time off to go work, and there was no bigger motivator in my life to go back to school than getting a real job. So do that. I mean, when I was a junior, my third year of undergrad, I couldn't wait to get out of school. And here I am like 15 years later, right? I did an internship. I did one summer internship and came back from it and said, I'm going to graduate school. And then I got a master's, and then I worked again for 18 months and said, I'm going back to school. Honestly, it's different for everyone, but I would say one thing is that once you get into the research aspect of graduate school, it's nothing like your undergraduate. So if you're burnt out on classes, that'll end once you finish your course requirement, really. If you're burnt out on classes, though, coming straight to UCI might not be a good idea. You gotta take a lot of them. So, yeah. I guess look at your programs, think about what it is that what your motivation for going is really good. Maybe I gave a bad example because just hating working isn't like, it's not enough of a motivation to finish a PhD, to be perfectly honest. You're gonna drop, like you will be one of the attrition numbers because you're working probably longer days, a lot less money than all of your peers are making. And your job prospects don't open up a ton unless you really, really, really wanna be a professor. Otherwise, you could get more or less the same place with the same amount of time in industry. So. Yeah, that's kind of my philosophy, is that make sure you really want it. And also, I like to discourage people who don't really want to be there to not go to graduate school, because it kind of ruins it for the rest of us. Because if you go now, if you showed up in any master's or graduate level course here at UCI, there's a good chance you're sitting in a class the same size as one of your undergraduate courses. I think professional masters have really changed what grad school is about for a lot of people, and it's not like, I don't know, it's not a great experience. If you really don't want to be there, then I don't know why people are. So, yeah, I don't know. Apply, so you have the option, I would say. If you're not sure, just apply, because getting the most options you can have is the best idea. So I applied to jobs and grad school when I graduated. And then I had the luxury of deciding between a job offer and graduate school. So
I was definitely burnt out after 4 years, and I luckily interned and had a job offer straight up and was like, I'm leaving school, like, we're getting far away from this as possible. And you know, I got into industry and realized that I wasn't as creative as when I was in school. You know, I wasn't working on the creative type projects, and slowly tried to find my way back. But yeah, I mean, that burnout is real, and you should find ways to set yourself up to succeed and like move past the burnout in graduate school and, you know, find other outlets in that case. Or, you know, you took a year, go around the world and take a break and do grad school a year later. But it's definitely worth trying to figure out what you exactly want to do instead of just grinding yourself to death by going straight through. So yeah, the burnout's real. I mean, I took some graduate courses in my undergrad, which also probably made the burnout worse. But yeah, I say go work, do some other stuff, and then come back if you need to. So
great, thank you.
So I did have some burnout problems with like trying to perform academically when I was an undergrad, but that actually really did change as soon as I started doing research. Then like I started having more drive in what I was doing, and so like I started like really acing on my classes because I was really interested in what I was trying to learn and how to apply that to the things that I wanted to do, like when I was going forward. And at least the thing about when I did my master's, and at least how I was able to do that, was that I had a lot of freedom to choose what classes I wanted to take, and that totally changed how I experienced those classes. Because, like, I don't know, they were all fun, and there were things I wanted to learn and things I wanted to do, and so, like, I didn't feel any burnout while I was going through them. You do feel burnout as you're going through your PhD, yes, because, I don't know, the PhD is a marathon. You'll sprint, you'll hit a wall, you'll have to just keep going at some point, but then it becomes a time of trying to figure out how to pace yourself and to mix things up so that you don't get burned out, because it happens a lot in the PhD.
Thank you.
So a lot of what's been said already, you know, I took a little bit of time off. I got lucky because my program ended in December and grad school in the States starts in September. So I got 9 months to sort of take random courses, go do random projects, all the side projects that have been piling up at the end of undergrad I finally got to do. So that was nice. And it meant that like when I came to UCI, I was sort of like, I was ready. I was like, I am ready to do some work again, some directed work. I need some more structure back in my life. This whole like unstructured lifestyle wasn't very productive. And so when I came to grad school, I was really amped. And that sort of powered me through the first 2 years. And again, like, you know, it's a marathon, but there's also like these cycles that you go through as you have these like major milestones. You sort of like build up and you start getting really stressed out and you start working harder and harder, and then you crash, and then you sort of like take not 9 months off again, but you take a couple of weeks, or you take a week, or sometimes you only need a day or two. Depends on what the milestone was and what it is. But you figure out a system after that. And so, you know, since then, it's been sort of just waves. But really nice ones now, because I know how to deal with them, and I know what the pattern looks like. So it's easier to deal with once you start like figuring out how you sort of you function as a human being in the world.
Great, thank you.
So I was completely burned out when I finished my undergraduate and took 2 years off, and that's fine. But again, I will urge you, if you do that, have your professors write the letters for you and keep them on file right then before you leave while you're still fresh in their mind and they remember all of the good things about you instead of, yes, I think I remember a couple of years ago. So get them to keep the letters on file. More questions from the audience? Please.
What's your work schedule like as a grad student and how much free time do you get?
Could you repeat the question, please?
What's your work schedule like and how much free time do you get? This is a really hard question for me to answer now because I really like what I do, which means that the line between work and chilling out sometimes gets a little blurred because I am reading the papers for fun, but it's also, I know that I'm burning out if I read too many of them. And so I sort of, I don't force myself to follow a 9-to-5. At some point I think in the first 2 years, I tried to force myself to do a 9-to-5. I was like, I should be, you know, working these many hours, or I should be working all of the time. And now I've sort of taken the approach of, I'm in research mode, I should just do what I need to do when I need to do it. And so it kind of means that I'm always working, but I'm also, you know, I can paint for 2 hours in the morning and not feel guilty about it too much because I realize that I'm probably going to work 2 extra hours in the middle of the night. And so now I just sort of like let the world happen to me, which is maybe not a very good way of describing it. But it means that I'm not trying to like actually force this much. So instead I have a to-do list and it's actually the act of getting things done, which means that again, my weeks are like this, right? Some weeks I'm working ridiculous hours and not really doing anything else, and other weeks, you know, it's a little more chill. But for the most part, grad school is pretty intense, so don't expect to be, you know, cruising through either. I think in the beginning it's really helpful, it was really helpful to have the structure because that at least helped me figure out what my rhythm of work looked like. And so having that in the beginning to sort of like hold you in place and help you sort of like get through this whole weird transition phase that you're going through and then figure out how you want to let go after that.
Okay, thank
you. I don't know if that's helpful.
And then if anyone has additional comments, we'll take them, but we're about to have to wind down due to time, and I want to make sure that if there's any burning questions left, we get them answered.
What's the question?
Free time and schedule and structure.
Oh, right. So your schedule is a little bit more free now because you're kind of in dissertation mode.
Right.
There's another thing that I want to say about culture. Like, there's a culture of labs that may or may not already exist, but like, at least I've found, in order to keep a certain type of culture and to have certain things, because there's a lot can be said about having a group of people that are around the same time working. And so one, you can have these co-working environments, but also you can bounce ideas off of each other because you're free and available. But it takes time and effort to be able to show up and do those things. So, I mean, I've transitioned between like showing up whenever I want, having like various sort of diurnal or like swapped time schedules. But I've actually been pretty happy with having a sort of 9-to-5 or sometimes like 9 to 2 a.m. But schedules in which like I do have certain people around that I can talk to, and then I also have some periods of time where I'm just by myself working.
Right.
So. In the interests of time, I think we've covered that topic. Any other burning questions from the audience, or even questions, even if they're not burning, that you would like advice on? Okay, well, at this point, please thank the graduate students for their helpful advice. And on behalf of all the students in front of you and here at UCI, I extend my thanks as well. Everybody, please help yourself to pizza as you leave, and feel free to take extra slices to eat later. And thank you all for your kind attention, and thank our video. And Jessica, would you stand up? And I'd like to thank Jessica Shanahan, who organized the whole thing.